Ariel, thanks a lot. I'm really excited to be here as a graduate of the electrical engineering. Thank you for inviting me. Actually, I feel a little bit like a sandwich. First of all, I'm the middle talk between three talks. And the second reason, I have a great speaker before me, Jennifer, and a great Stefano is talking after me, so I'm in a big challenge. And the third sandwich, if you can guess from the introduction of Ariel, I was working for 5 years, actually not too far from Jennifer in AT&T, and then I worked 5 years at Cisco. I didn't interact with Stefano so much, but so a little bit of a sandwich here. I'll be talking about some architecture, multi-core architecture for mitigating some type of a denial of service attack. It's a collaborative work with Anat Bremler-Bar from IDC, with David Chai, who is here. Actually, all three of them have been here today. And Anat is teaching now. And David Chai from the Hebrew University. Yotam Arkol is a student of David and Anat. And Yoram Koral is a student of myself and Anat. So they've been supported by the ERC. Nice grant they got. Okay, so the topic is deep packet inspection. We need to process packets, and actually mostly I'm looking into the challenge of finding patterns within packets. Deep packet inspection doing a lot of different things, but we're looking mostly in finding malicious code, patterns of viruses and worms in intrusion prevention systems, intrusion detection system, or firewalls. When you have, you know, you go into a multi-core because that's the way things go with technology today. One option is to make a pipeline. You have a different cores doing different jobs of your intrusion prevention system, of your snort or any other device. But this turns out not to be so good because the DPI, the deep packet inspection, oh, that's a good machine to use. The DPI is a very heavy job, and the other processes like TCP normalization and the URL filtering is a much lighter job, and the pipeline is not balanced. So this is not a good solution, and that works. Second option is to do parallel multicore, and that's the approach that we use, and it's quite obvious. So when your packets arrive, now you have a lot of patterns. Those databases of patterns for intrusion prevention systems have thousands of patterns. So one option is to split the patterns into groups of patterns, let each core process one set of the patterns, find them in the packets. So now you need to split, to duplicate the packets and send them to the different cores. Turns out to be also not so efficient because usually you don't find the pattern in the packets. So all the cores are doing similar job of detecting that the patterns are not in the packet and doing a lot of duplication. So not a good approach. The second approach is actually to split the packets between the cores and have each core do the full job of deep packet inspection, of looking for the entire database of patterns within the packet it receives. So this is our starting point. And I can only tell you from my experience from the 5 years I spent at Cisco that as things happen, we want faster and faster routers, and we now have to build the routers in a multi-core environment. We took the huge Cisco routers with the iOS, with the operating systems of the router, and try to parallelize it. It's an impossible job because it's a legacy code. The problem itself, writing a router on a multicore, is embarrassingly parallel, but if you do it from the beginning. But now I have a 30 years old piece of code with thousands of engineers that have spent, I don't know how many thousands of man years on this code, go make it multicore. Really impossible. You have to now, companies like Cisco, Juniper, have to write the whole thing from scratch in order to get the scalability which is required today with multi-cores. Back to our problem. So here is an attack. We have a two-step attack, and this is the attack we will mitigate in the next slides, in the rest of the talk. So we have packets that are very easy to build. The attackers spend very little energy on crafting those packets. but require a lot of energy from the security device or from the computer to process them. And those attacks, you see them quite often today in the internet. It's a two-step attack. First, step number one, the attacker sends some complex packets and it takes the security device down. Now when the security device is down, some of them go into a shortcut mode, and now this sends the packet to steal the credit cards or to destroy whatever property the secure device was supposed to protect. So our purpose is to protect the security device from these packets, from this red complex packets. Okay, as I told you, you have many of these attacks, like one of the famous one on Sony, that many credit cards have been stolen, and they used exactly this method of attack. Okay, we is mostly Yotam and Yaron, the two students did a lot of work here. We took a snort and we built, I'll show you in a minute how we construct the difficult packet, the complexity attack on snort, and you see how the throughput drops rapidly, and also the throughput of good packets, not attack packets. Already if 20% of the packets are bad packets, you already lose nearly 50% of your good put. So it's very easy to take down your security device with those packets. So this is the goal of the talk. The talk today is about architecture, multi-core architecture, to mitigate complexity attacks of different types. We'll use mostly the snort as an example, but it works for, we'll see some other examples. Let's consider an airline check-in. We have four check-in kiosks, and passengers are arriving for check-in. And one of the customers is starting to show signs of being a troublesome guy. He wants an aisle seat next to a window. He doesn't like the food. He has three bags, heavy bags. You can imagine going through the security. Some of you may have experienced it coming to Israel, going through security. You can probably come up with other incident. Doesn't like the food. Doesn't find his passport. Overweight. Takes a lot of time to process this guy. So this is a heavy customer. Okay, one heavy customer, we'll deal with him. The other customers just go to the other lines. What happens if there are a few more heavy customers exactly spread across the kiosk? There are not many of them, but just enough of them to block all the check-in kiosk. The flight is canceled and too bad. Airline industry, what they do, they simply have one trained attendee. She's usually very tough and mean. I have bad experiences with these people sometimes. For sometimes I forget things at home, I don't have my passport or something. But she's trained. She knows how to process the heavy customers only in 4 minutes because she's very tough, no bullshit. Okay, you go home. I can't say, you want to fly? You don't want to fly. Decide. And okay, I'll fly, I don't care the food, put me somewhere, I want to get home. And they move all the customers to this one line. So we can see there are four properties, and these four properties will go with us throughout the talk. We have heavy and light customers, the easy customers and the difficult ones. It's easy to detect the problematic customers, that look like me or some other mechanisms. It's easy to move customers between the different check-in lines, and we have a specially trained attendee to deal with the difficult customers. Replace customers with packets, and that's what roughly we do with the complexity attack. Complexity attack are the heavy customers. So let's see that we can have heavy customers. How do we construct heavy customers on snort, to attack snort? So to do the deep packet inspection, to find the patterns within the packet, snort and other IPS and IDS system use a deterministic finite state machine. You walk through the machine state by state on each arriving byte. You jump to the next state according to the matrix of next states. to detect, if you reach all the way down to a final state, you detect a pattern. So it's a huge matrix, doesn't fit into the cache of the machines. It's, the patterns are thousands of bytes long, and there are thousands of patterns because there are many attacks, and it doesn't fit into the machine. So what we do to create an attack, we take the database of the patterns, which exist open on the internet. We put a factory to build the bad packets on the left. From all of the patterns, we chop off the last two bytes because we don't want to actually detect a pattern. We just want to do all the work until we almost detect a pattern. And then we start constructing the heavy packets simply by concatenating patterns one after the other, another packet and another set of patterns. And this way, we construct as many heavy packets as we want, different combination of patterns, and this is the attack. Very easy to craft heavy packet. That's what you have to do. It's a trivial job. But on the side of the IPS, it's a very difficult job to process these packets because the matrix that I showed you before is a huge matrix. Only a small part of it fit into the cache. And there are common states, the states that I visit most frequently in most of the normal packets are usually in the cache. So in a normal traffic, I just go, no, this is not a pattern, another packet, another tile, and I very quickly see that those packets don't match any pattern. Under an attack, with the packet that we saw, we go and we get a lot of cache misses because each time we go to a new line in the matrix, not frequently visited state, and we evict the normal packets, the normal lines from the cache, and we make it hard also for the normal traffic that comes right after the heavy packet. And as you can see, the throughput drops, as we saw it before, rapidly due to the heavy packets. So it's easy to craft them and very hard to process them. That's what we wanted. Like the airline customers, the difficult ones, and so we have established this point, and we move to the next point. We want to be able to detect them in the IPS, on the cores. How easy is it to detect them? Well, it's very easy because they have few cache misses, and the heavy packets have a lot of cache misses. Well, first of all, we initially counted the cache misses, but that's a heavy job. It requires an IO operation sometimes to read the cache misses counter. It's not something you want to use online in operation all the time. And besides, the heavy packets evicted some lines from the cache, and now the good packets also suffer from extra cache misses, so they could have a lot of cache misses, even though they are good packets. So instead, we took the percent of non-common state. Those are the states that I showed you before. Before we do the operation, we run some traces. We learn what are the common states that are visited very frequently by normal traffic. We mark them. And when a packet arrives, we count how many non-common state and common state are there in the packet, starting from the 20th byte of the packet. If it's beyond a certain threshold, it's a bad packet. So we easily detect the bad packets. And we move on to the ability to move them between the queues. So let me show you the architecture that we are using. So we have here the cores. Each of them is processing a normal operation. All of them process all of the patterns. Each core has its input queue, getting packets from the network interface card. We use it actually, we use a machine that Intel donated to Tel Aviv University, and that machine actually is running all the tests. It's a 20 core, actually it's a 10 cores and 10 cores, two 10 cores chips, Westmere of Intel. And when we are under attack, we detect that there are heavy packets and enough percentage of heavy packets is beyond a certain threshold. We move to protection mode, and the key idea is to dedicate a fraction of the cores only to process heavy packets. So When you detect a heavy packet, like this one, you move it to the one of the dedicated cores. To simplify the communication, we have an input queue for heavy packets for each of the good cores. So core number one have an input queue on the dedicated core. Core number two is a different queue, so they don't need to synchronize, and we solve a lot of synchronization issues. And if you gave core number nine heavy packet, you steal from it two normal packets, hopefully normal, you still don't know if they're heavy or normal, to balance the load of the different cores. So that's how the architecture, roughly speaking, works with the stealing of the good packets. Well, we established that it's easy to move between cores, specifically because what I told you, that we have a separate input queue for each of the good, for the normal cores inside the heavy processing, the dedicated cores. Last point, it's not a must, but it's it will be nice to have also the staff attendee that knows how to process the difficult customers in an efficient way. So luckily, my co-authors had a paper already written half a year ago, where it's actually continuing a long line of research, they're not the first one to have it, where they introduced a compressed aho-coracic algorithm, where I don't keep a matrix, but for each state, I keep only the necessary next step if I move down the state machine, or one state, one transition if I move back in the state machine, if I go to a prefix. When using this compressed representation, I can fit the entire state machine in the cache. However, each byte that arrives, I need to do a lot more processing, or not a lot more, but I have to do more processing. But I have to do several lookups to find what is my next step. It's not one lookup into a predefined spot in the matrix. I have to go on the list of possible next steps from a given state. So if we look at the processing, this is the full matrix performance. When there are many good packets and very few heavy packets, it performs much better. And this is the performance of the compressed algorithm. No cache misses. It works as hard. It works as hard if there are good packets or heavy packets, so it maintains constant throughput. This throughput includes the throughput of heavy packets throughout, even if all the packets are heavy. While the full matrix algorithm, its performance drops rapidly, as you can see. So we have an algorithm, the compressed aho-coracic. This is, will be the attendee that knows how to handle difficult customers. And we established all 4 points, all four properties. Let me show you some experimental results. So we first simply took the actual snort. We applied the attack on snort. And after this 1 second is an artifact of our implementation. It could be also 50 milliseconds or a short period of time after the attack, you can start the protection, the mitigation of the attack, moving into dedicated cores and normal cores. And as you can see, the throughput of the good traffic, the good packets, is hardly affected. It's because the dedicated cores take all the difficult, the heavy packets, they take, sheet, but they take all the sheet and process it, and the normal cores are dedicated for the good traffic and can maintain its throughput. And you can see that we can also process a good, the heavy packets. So if you just expect not to have an attack, you expect to have maybe sometimes period of time with more heavy packets than normal, it's a good architecture to use just to increase your performance and not to fall, as I showed you in the previous experiment, and I'll show you on the next slide. And as I said, the 1 second is an artifact of our algorithm. It could easy, it's just a parameter. So here you see the performance of the different algorithms in our architecture, with or without our architecture. The top line is using our architecture, and when you detect a heavy packet, you drop it. You don't even bother. That's what actually what my belief is. If you are under attack, forget the bad packets. You don't need them and you don't want to see them. Just drop them. Right, there might be some normal packets that erroneously have been indicated as bad packets. So we might, some customers might suffer a little bit, but under attack, I want to protect the legitimate traffic and give it full service. Additionally, I claim this area is none of our interest. We are protecting against complexity attacks, where the number, a small number of packets brings my system down. I'm not protecting bandwidth attacks. Those are bandwidth attacks, because if there are a lot of heavy packets, it's already the job of the upstream ISP or upstream routers to protect and block those attacks. So we only need to look at this side of the graph. And as you see, when we drop, the performance of our system is really great, hardly affected. The complexity attack is almost unnoticeable. With our dedicated cores, still our architecture performs much better than any of the other algorithms, both the compressed and the non-compressed air coracic algorithm. You can see on 20% of the packets are attack, we are about 40% better than the usual system. We improve its performance. And the compressed, why is the compressed going down here? Because we only count the good put. This graph shows the throughput of normal, of legitimate packets, not the throughput of bad packets. So that's now, this line is now going down and not going straight as in the previous slide. Is it moving? Yeah. So let's consider a different attack, not a cache miss attack and not an attack on Snort, but on a different security device. It's also an intrusion prevention system called the hybrid finite automaton attack. Nowadays, many of the patterns that we need to detect are actually regular expression. What you saw until now, the Snort detects fixed patterns with some variations. But it says if I have from character 80 in the packet, I have a certain pattern. Here we look into machines that it's a non-deterministic machine to detect regular expression patterns. Regular expression, you can have, if I have A appear any number of times, this is the type of a regular expression, or a certain character can appear arbitrary number of times, and then the pattern continues. The main difficulty of non-deterministic finite automaton is that you, in parallel, go into several active states. So in a snapshot, you are now process several next steps. A byte come in, you need to decide what is the next step from each of the active states. And you have several active states when you have a non-deterministic machine. So the algorithms that have been used, the hybrid finite automaton, portion of the machine are deterministic finite state, and part of the machine is combination of non-deterministic elements. The end result is most of, under normal traffic, most of the time you have three active states, up to three, sometimes four active states. You are not going into many active states concurrently, because if there are many active states concurrently, your performance are down on the floor. It's a lot of cache misses, it's a lot of processing for each packet, it's consuming a lot of cycles from the CPU. It's not just cache misses, it's memory and CPU cycles. So this is the main point here, that with several active states. So as before, under normal traffic, the number of active states is small, as I told you. Under attack, we have, this is an attack, we start to get many active states concurrently. And that brings the performance of the intrusion prevention system or the firewall down. And you have an attack. This, I will not go through all the details as we did on Snort, but we will go over it rather quickly. So the average number of active states in normal traffic is up to three states, as I told you. Under attack, it's very easy to craft packets, to construct packets where the number of active states is 7 or more. This is also an artifact of our experiment. It can be 7, 8, or more. So it's easy to put a threshold. It's easy to detect because the number of active states is readily available for you in the program. It's not something you have to measure and test. And with our system, we implemented the protection from this to mitigate this attack with our system. And we see that the performance with our system is much better. Look, only 10% of the packets are bad packets. This one is down on the floor, and we are still performing very well. That's our architecture. Okay, so basically we saw an architecture to mitigate complexity attacks. And with this talk, I showed you two attacks. I showed you the attack on snort and the attack on the hybrid finite automaton. We also have implemented it for the Bro intrusion prevention system, which is a different attack. It doesn't attack the cache and not the CPU, but another resource of the processor. And we believe this approach is actually a good approach also for other more generalized than security devices where you have special processing like the airline desk or other applications for this type of architecture. So I saw the slides yesterday. I was very impressed by Radu's catamaran, not surfing, but sailboat. So I said, I have to find something similar. So this morning I was going through my slide and I did deep packet inspection in the Red Sea. So that's me doing deep packet inspection, really deep, about 25 meter deep. And I highly recommend, this is a very good deep packet inspection, no complexity attacks. And okay, thanks a lot.